Hello guys, let me talk about hemolytic uremic syndrome today. Hemolytic uremic syndrome was described by Gazer in a German publication in 1955. Hemolytic uremic syndrome consists of a triad of macroangiopathic hemolytic anemia, thrombocytopenia, and acute renal failure. This is the most common form of thrombotic macroangiopathy in children. The clinical course of hemolytic uremic syndrome can vary from subclinical to a life-threatening form. Hemolytic uremic syndrome has clinical features in common with thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura. Both these include multi-organ dysfunction due to thrombotic microangiopathy with active hemolysis and thrombocytopenia. The traditional classification describes patients with predominantly renal disease as having HUS and the patients with predominantly CNS disease as having TTP. However, hemolytic uremic syndrome can include severe neurologic impairment and TTP can also cause severe renal failure, and involvement of other organ systems also overlaps. So, as a way to differentiate TTP and HUS, fever is commonly and mainly seen in TTP. It is the pentad of TTP, and severe CNS manifestation is more common in TTP than HUS. And the thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura is more common in adults, whereas HUS is more common in children. When we see the etiology of hemolytic uremic syndrome, there are several etiologies for the disease. However, we distinctly classify them into three main groups. The first one is Shiga toxin producing E. coli, which is used to describe hemolytic uremic syndrome caused by Shiga toxin produced E. coli. This is called classic hemolytic uremic syndrome or typical hemolytic uremic syndrome or diarrhea associated hemolytic uremic syndrome. This Shiga toxin producing E. coli associated hemolytic uremic syndrome accounts for about 90% of all HUS cases in childhood. The second one is atypical HUS. It is used to describe hemolytic uremic syndrome which is not mediated by Shiga toxin. This is also called diarrhea negative or non-diarrhea associated hemolytic uremic syndrome. This disease is usually mediated by abnormalities of the complement system or other heritable factors. The third one is a pneumococcal associated HUS. It's a subtype of atypical hemolytic uremic syndrome, and it is mediated by neuroaminidase in the presence of infection with Streptococcus pneumonia. This is also called neuroaminidase mediated hemolytic uremic syndrome. The distinction is important because the clinical course, treatment, and the prognosis differ for each category. About 90% of all HUS cases in childhood is caused by Shiga toxin producing E. coli, whereas in certain areas of the world, the toxin of Shigella dysentery type 1 is a causative agent for diarrhea associated hemolytic uremic syndrome. Several serotypes of E. coli can produce the toxin, whereas the O157H7 is the most common one. This commonly is transmitted by the undercooked meat or unpasteurized milk because the reservoir of Shiga toxin producing E. coli is the intestinal tract of domestic animals. A rare but distinct entity of infectious triggered HUS is related to the neuroaminidase producing strep pneumonia, as we have said above, and HUS typically is severe and it develops during acute infection with this organism, and typically it manifests as pneumonia with empyema. In atypical or non-diarrheal HUS or genetic forms of HUS, this is due to the inherited deficiency of either von Willebrand's factor cleaving protease or Adam's Certes or complement factor H or I can cause HUS. A major feature characteristics of genetic forms of HUS is the absence of preceding diarrheal prodrome. Genetic forms of HUS can be indolent and are remitting once they become manifest, or they can have a relapsing pattern precipitated by an infectious illness. When we see the pathology, kidney biopsy are only rarely performed in HUS because the diagnosis is usually established by clinical criteria, and the risk of biopsy are significant during the active phase of the disease. Early glomerular changes include thickening of the glomerular capillary walls caused by swelling of the endothelial cells and accumulation of fibrillar material between endothelial cells and the underlying basement membrane. And this causes narrowing of the capillary lumens. Platelet fibrin thrombi are often seen in glomerular capillaries. Thrombi are also seen in afferent arterioles and the small arteries within fibrinoid necrosis of arterial wall. This leads to renal cortical necrosis from vascular occlusion. The late findings include glomerular sclerosis and obsolescence secondary to either severe direct glomerular involvement or glomerular ischemia from arterial involvement. When we see the pathogenesis of hemolytic uremic syndrome, microvascular injury with endothelial cell damage is a characteristic of all forms of thrombotic microangiopathy, including HUS. In the diarrhea-associated form of HUS, enteropathic organisms produce either Shiga toxin or the highly homologous Shiga-like verotoxin. These toxins are easily absorbed from the colonic mucosa into the systemic circulation after the colonic mucosa is damaged by the bacteria. And then they bind to the endothelial cells in the glomerulus and elsewhere and directly cause endothelial cell damage. Shiga toxin can also directly activate platelet to promote their aggregation. Mechanical injury to the RBC passing through the thrombotic microvasculature results in severe non-immune anemia with a negative direct combust test. In pneumococcal associated HUS, neuraminidase cleaves sialic acid on membranes of endothelial cells, red cells and the platelets to expose the underlying antigen, and this causes exposure for immunoglobulin antibodies to trigger hemolysis, and then they form anemia with a positive direct combust test. The familial recessive and the dominant forms of HUS, including the inherited deficiency of RAM 13 and the regulation of complement cascade, probably predispose atypical HUS for these clinical manifestations. In each form of HUS, capillary and arterial endothelial injury in the kidney leads to localized thrombosis, particularly in the glomerulus, causing a direct decrease in GFR. Progressive platelet aggregation in the areas of macrovascular injury results in conservative thrombocytopenia. Microangiopathic hemolytic anemia results from mechanical damage to red cell as they pass through the damaged and the thrombotic microvasculature. When we see the clinical manifestation of hemolytic uremic syndrome, HUS male diarrhea associated is most common in preschool and school age children, but it can occur in adolescents and adults. HUS is caused by toxigenic E. coli, and the onset of HUS occurs 5 to 7 days after the onset of gastroenteritis with fever, vomiting, abdominal pain, and diarrhea. No age predilection is noted for atypical hemolytic uremic syndrome, whereas the diarrhea associated form is most common in preschool and school age children. The prodromal intestinal symptoms might be severe and it requires hospitalization, but they can also be relatively mild and considered trivial. The diarrhea is often bleeding, but it's not necessarily so. Following the prodromal illness, the sudden onset of pallor, weakness, and lethargy heralds the onset of hemolytic uremic syndrome, and it reflects the development of microangiopathic hemolytic anemia. Oliguria can present in early stage, but might be masked by ongoing diarrhea. Because the prodromal enteritis often overlaps the onset of HUS, particularly with ingestion of large dose of toxins. Thus, patients with HUS can present with either significant dehydration or they might present with significant volume overload, depending on whether the enteritis or whether the renal insufficiency from HUS predominates, and the amount of fluid that has been administered also matters. Patients with pneumococcal-associated HUS usually are quite ill with pneumonia, empyema, and bacteremia when they develop HUS. The onset can be insidious in patients with genetic forms of HUS, with HUS triggered by a variety of illness, including mild non-specific GI or respiratory infections. HUS can be relatively mild, or it can progress to severe and fatal multisystemic disease. Leukocytosis, severe prodromal enteritis, hyponatremia, antibiotic use portend the severe courses, but no presenting features reliably predict the severity of HUS in any given patient. Patients with HUS who appear mildly affected at presentation can rapidly develop severe multisystem life-threatening complications. Renal insufficiency can be mild, but it can also rapidly evolve to severe oliguric or anuric renal failure. The combination of rapidly developing renal failure and the severe hemolysis can also predispose for life-threatening hyperkalemia. Severe acute kidney injury requiring dialysis develops in about 50% of patients with diarrhea-associated HUS. The duration of dialysis requirements is usually about 2 weeks. Volume overload, hypertension, and severe anemia can also develop soon after the onset of HUS and together can precipitate heart failure. The majority of patients with HUS have some CNS involvement. Most have mild manifestation with significant irritability, lethargy, or non-specific encephalopathic features. And the severe CNS involvement occurs in only less than 20% of cases. Seizure and the significant cephalopathy are the most common manifestation in those with severe CNS involvement, resulting from focal ischemia, secondary to microvascular CNS thrombosis. Small infarction in the basal ganglia and the cerebral cortex have also been reported, but large strokes and intracranial hemorrhage is rare. Hypertension may also produce encephalopathy and seizure. In certain patients, intestinal complications can be seen, and they include severe inflammatory colitis, ischemic enterites, bowel perforation, intussusception, or pancreatitis can be seen. Patients can develop PTK, but significant or severe bleeding is rare despite very low platelet counts. When we see the diagnosis and the differential diagnosis for patients with HUS, the diagnosis is made by the combination of microangiobiotic hemolytic anemia with schistocytes, thrombocytopenia, and some degree of kidney involvement. The anemia can be mild at presentation, but rapidly progress to severe form. Thrombocytopenia is an invariable finding in the acute phase, with platelet count usually less than 100,000. PT, PTT, and INR are normal most of the time. Combustest is negative in DR-associated one, except in pneumococcal-induced HUS, where the combustest is usually positive. Leukocytosis is often present and significant, and the urine analysis typically shows microscopic hematuria and low-grade proteinuria. The renal insufficiency can vary from mild elevation in serum BUN and the creatinine to acute anuric kidney injury. The etiology of HUS is often clear with the presence of diarrhea, prodrome, or pneumococcal infection, and the presence or absence of toxigenic organisms can on stool culture has little role in making the diagnosis of diarrhea-associated HUS, because only a minority of patients infected with these organisms develop HUS, and the organisms that cause HUS may be rapidly cleared. Therefore, the stool culture is often negative in patients who have diarrhea-associated HUS. If there is no history of diarrhea prodrome or pneumococcal infection is obtained, then evaluation for genetic forms of HUS should be considered, because those patients are at risk for recurrence, have severe prognosis, and they can benefit from different therapy. Other causes of acute kidney injury associated with microangiobiotic hemolytic anemia and thrombocytopenia should be considered, and they should be excluded. For example, SLE, malignant hypertension, and the bilateral renal vein thrombosis can cause microangiobiotic hemolytic anemia, thrombocytopenia, and anemia. Kidney biopsy is rarely indicated to diagnose HUS. When we see the treatment, early recognition, intensive supportive care, and monitoring for potential complications is very important with meticulous supportive care. Supportive care includes management of fluid and electrolytes, including prompt correction of volume deficits, control of hypertension, early institution of dialysis if the patient became significantly oligonucleic or anuric, particularly with hyperkalemia. Early intravenous volume expansion before the onset of oliguria or anuria might be nephroprotective in DR-associated HUS. And red cell transfusions are usually required because hemolysis can be brisk and recurrent until the active phase of the disease has been resolved. In pneumococcal-associated HUS, it is critical that any administered red blood cell should be washed before transfusion to remove residual plasma because of endogenous IgM directed against the revealed T antigen that can play a role in accelerating the pathogenesis of the disease. Platelet should generally not be administered, regardless of the platelet count, to patients with HUS, because they are rapidly consumed by the active coagulation, and they are theoretically going to worsen the clinical course if we transfuse them. Despite low platelet count, serious bleeding is very rare in patients with HUS. The other is antibiotic therapy. Antibiotic therapy to clear enteric toxigenic organisms can result in increased toxin release. This causes potentially exacerbates the disease. So therefore, antibiotic administration is usually is not recommended. However, prompt treatment of causative pneumococcal infection is important. So antibiotic administration is contraindicated if it is diarrhea associated, whereas we should have to treat with antibiotics if it is pneumococcal associated HUS. Plasma infusion or plasma pharesis for severe manifestation of HUS with serious CNS involvement is also considered in some centers. And also eculizumab, which is an anti-CD5 antibody that inhibits complement activation, a pathway that contributes to activities in some forms of atypical familial HUS. So this pathway will also contribute to the process of diarrhea associated HUS. So eculizumab is approved for the treatment of atypical HUS. Plasma therapy can be of substantial benefit to patients with ADAMS-RT deficiency or factor H deficiency. When we see the prognosis, the mortality rate for diarrhea associated HUS is less than 5% in best setup with good care, and the pneumococcal associated HUS causes increased patient morbidity, more than 80% requiring dialysis with the mortality rate approaching up to 20%, and the familiar or genetic forms of HUS can be insidiously progressive or relapsing disease and have a poorer prognosis. Please don't forget to subscribe. Thank you.